She got very excited about this communist idea and the political meetings and everything. And she said she was
very young then. She was like 14, 15?
Well, yeah. She thought it was very interesting.
This one?
Yes. And somebody said to her mother, tell your daughter to keep away from the meetings because they're watching who goes in. And then there was and then she tells a story that one night they came to the shop and they tried to break in, and her mother said to the children, go to every window, open the, they lived above the shop, that often happened, I think, you had a shop downstairs and you lived upstairs. She said, go to the window and open the windows and shout out, Yidin Ratave, save us Jews. And she said it was a cold winter night and there were Jews davening or something in another, not far, they heard and they came out and the people ran away who were going to break into the shop and steal. And they said to her, we'll come back. They said to them, don't worry Jews, we'll be back. We will break into your shop. And then the mother said, let's collect everything and get the hell out. And they went back to Poland.
Well, they went to Poland. They left
They went to Tambov because the father...
Tambov was Russia?
Was Russia. The father was looking for something better, obviously, and he died there. And they had a lot of money. Because she says that when they came back to Poland, when they collected all their money and they were on the way back, somebody said to them, you'll have money for Kindle's Kindle. For your children's children, you'll have money, but it was Kerensky money, because the new government had printed money, and it was Kerensky money, who was the in-between, and the communist replaced Kerensky with their government, and their money became nothing. And that's what I told you yesterday, and that's why wanted property.
Have you ever seen that money?
No.
I've seen money like that Dave's father brought to South Africa with him.
Kerensky money?
Each note is about that size.
Wow, really?
And he had suitcases of it.
It was worthless. And they had suitcases of worthless money.
Yeah.
And that was her lesson for life. She said, we only buy bricks, we buy property, we buy land. We don't keep money. She was right.
So then they came back,
and then all of them lived, grew up, and the boys went to study in Bialystok, dental mechanic. And then I think Solly got into trouble, and I think Solly must have had this fight with somebody, and they hid him. At this, I remember my mom said that they hid him somewhere in an attic until they could get him out of Lapy.
Solly or the dead man?
Okay. So that may have been the... So the two went to South Africa.
They
and mother in the meantime got married.
Which one?
And my mother. And in the meantime she had a child and her mother died.
And that's when
and Solly and Sam sent money all the time back to Russia, back to Poland, all the time. What they had, they sent back to the family. And then it must have been decided that my father would try his luck too and get in because things were not...
They couldn't get him a visa?
No, so he went to South Africa and they paid money to... My mother called them Stadtlerneb and they used to run to Pretoria to try and wangle out some sort of certificate to stay.
Tell the story about Grandma Kassovs.
About? And then and they said no. And you remember, if you remember South African history, there was a time when they didn't want Eightlanders anymore.
Absolutely.
And that's exactly when it changed. So in other words, the two brothers got in, but the brother-in-law couldn't get in anymore. And anyway, he got to a man called Rabbi Kassovsky. And Rabbi Kassovsky writes a letter to somebody he knows in Nairobi. And he says, which Charles has that letter, that there's a Jew here from Poland and he has to leave and he's got a wife and family. Can you find anything for him? And the man writes back and he says, yes, we'll find something.
Last minute,
so he goes on to Kenya. And he falls in love with Kenya. And he goes on to a farm. He becomes a farmer in his old age. Becomes a farmer.
How old was he then?
He's 40.
40. I guess.
You can ask Charles. And he becomes, and he loves Kenya, and my mother keeps writing letters and telling him what's happening.
How long was he away from your mother?
About a year. She knew, she must have known very well that their lives were in terrible danger. He got back just in time to take her.
Yeah.
Okay. How did he do that? He did it. He got a letter from my mother saying, from this moment that you get the letter, the life of the two boys is on your shoulders and on your conscience. You don't get us out, you know what's going to happen, because Charles got boxed in the ear and he's got bleeding ears, and they tried to throw Taffy off the train, and the man that and she must have been getting ready, because she sold the shop underneath them, she sold. And the boys who had always been playing in the garden and sitting on that gate, one of them or both of them played on the gate, they rode on the gate. And the person who just, she gives them a name, Mr. Such and Such, who just bought the shop underneath her, he grabbed them, somebody by the throat, one of them, and said, I'll kill you, Jew, if I see you on my gate again. So she read the writing on the wall. She knew that this is it. And she said to my dad, and with that letter, he went to the Jewish guy who'd medics. And medics took him, or medics, or somebody else.
Who was
Charles
medics?
Will tell you. One of the person who gave him the job on the farm and said, this is what my wife's written. I've got to go. And he said, and he took him to the British High Commissioner, who gave him, who allowed
him
to go and come back with the wife and the two children, because the Jewish man had given his assurance that he would be responsible for them, whatever they did in Kenya.
The medics.
Yeah.
Do you have any contact with them?
Well, I think there's still parts of the family there. But many years later, when I used to come back from South Africa or from Israel, I can't remember, on holiday, and we used to have Friday nights, and there were so many people at the table, this grumpy old man used to come get invited. But then I said, well, why do you keep inviting him? She said, because he is the nephew of that medics
Not the original.
He is from that family, and while he's alive and I can have him for dinner, he's always there.
She won't forget what
she
did.
She won't forget, because his family saved us. His family saved us. I didn't know that. So that was the story.
The story, it's really nice.
How my mother met my father?
Yeah.
So she used to go to Bialystok to bring material goods for the, because she was a big girl. The brothers were small, and she used to be her mother's right hand.
It was only about 3 years difference between mom and dad.
Yes, but she stood in the shop with my mother.
Okay.
And she used to go to Bialystok and do the buying, and
your mother did?
My mother. Her mother used to send her out to do the buying with a big list. She used to go and she used to buy. There was a Jewish man that she worked with there, and he liked her very much. And at one time she had a photograph taken of herself, and she looked very nice on that photograph. And he asked for the photograph piece. He said, could he have a copy? Because he's told his family all about this Rachel or Rachel and Rochele or whatever, and they want to see her picture. He took it to Michalova. To his family. His daughter was friends of my father's sister. So she asked to have a look at it, and she showed it to my father. And
from that stage on, he pursued her in such a way that 3 months later she said she was married. She said her mother encouraged this, and she didn't want to get married because she wanted to go to New Zealand, she said. She had it in her head that she was leaving to New Zealand. Have it on tape.
She meant Disneyland, of course.
I think she meant to get away from here. And she wanted to go away.
How old was she when she got married?
She wasn't so young. She must have been 23, 24. In those days, I don't think, but she did not want to get married. And she said he pursued her in such a way it was impossible to get rid of him. He was everywhere, and he decided that's what he wanted. And that's what he was going to have. And the mother said, I'm not well. Get married. I'm not well. I want to see you married. Did she marry?
He was a rabbi Kosofsky.
Which was
Dornfontein.
Yes, same rabbi. Yeah, we all knew. I knew his daughter. His daughter was our madricha, Rivka. She was the most beautiful girl. He was very ugly. He was so ugly.
My father.
Are you sure it's the same?
Yes,
sure
same one. He's well known.
My father used to worship this man in a way.
Really?
This Kosofsky was such a special man.
This
rabbi. No.
That's right.
That's a Jewish man. Said
gave
he'll,
him that money.
He'll, if he, when he comes back to South Africa. After his tour in Berlin, and my dad took him around.
Yeah, he went back to Lapy. He was from Lapy.
He was from Lapy.
Yeah, and he met him in a boarding house that my dad was staying at in Berlin.
Yeah,
he was my dad, after he qualified,
got his ticket for mechanic. There wasn't work in Poland.
Bialystok.
There wasn't work in Bialystok or in that area, so he went to Berlin to look for work. And he stayed in a. And he stayed in a boarding house, which was a Jewish boarding house in Berlin, which was in Fred Aranya Boomstrasse. Aranya Strasse, which I went to have a look at. We'll see it again. And he met this guy by the name of
Gilkin,
who had come to
tourist.
No, he was in South Africa and came to visit his family from Lapy. Understood, or from this area, and he met him there, and he said to him, "Gorfil, come in Africa." He says, "Who is Africa?" I didn't know where Africa was. Anyhow, he said, "I'll send you papers if I can find work for you there." And my dad didn't find work in Berlin, went back to Bialystok, to Lapy, and
Wapi.
And a couple of months later, he got papers, and the guy had actually put up money for him in South Africa to come to South Africa.
He sent him money for the boat trip and another £6.
Was he single at that time?
He was a 19-year-old, 18-year-old.
So he got...
But why? Did he keep in contact with this guy?
No, this guy...
He never met him
and never found him again.
I remember that he said he paid him whatever he used for salary.
Cape Town on the boat.
Your dad.
And he had Gilkin's address in Pretoria. But he didn't know where Pretoria was. So he stood at the tram stop in Cape Town to take the tram to Pretoria. Until somebody put him straight and told him that Pretoria is 1,000 miles away. And the tram doesn't run very frequently. So he landed up in Cape Town, where he got work pretty soon with a dentist by the name of Collifson. And he worked for Collifson until he heard about, and we knew Collifson. I remember the daughter, Sylvia Collifson. And he then heard about work available in a place called Vereeniging. And he left Collifson and went to work for Poe in Vereeniging.
Was Solly already there?
An Afrikaner.
Solly was there as well?
I don't know when Solly came.
Solly must have been one of the first to come out.
No.
Where did Solly go out?
Solly came after.
I don't know.
Solly came after he was already in Furin.
Yeah, a good few years.
A good few years after he was in Furinachem, because he in Furinachem wasn't with Solly. Solly came to Johannesburg.
Just hang on 1 second.
Who was his big chaver? And Louis Hirsch's uncle, who had a farm. And none of them spoke English properly. And he asked his nephew, Label. They all spoke a mixture of English and Yiddish. He said to him, Label, hast du gesehen meine Kuh? And Label said to him, Vetter, ich hab gesehen ein paar Kuh, aber ich weiß nicht, whether they sind ein Kuh zu Ochsen.
Can you just translate that?
A key is a cow.
In Yiddish.
And the man said to him, his dad asked, has he seen the key? But he asks in Yiddish with the word key. And the man answers, said he didn't see the key, but he doesn't know if it's male or female. If it's
cows or oxen.
He's answering him in Yiddish.
Anyway, and then at some stage, he used to go on weekends, after he worked for Poe during the week, he used to go to Johannesburg because that was the big city. It's about 40 miles from Vereeniging. Well, I suppose it was to look for Maidlich, but the excuse was that they did some extra work in Johannesburg, and that's when they opened the dental laboratory in Johannesburg.
Then
Solly was there. Solly was in that
what
thing.
What year was that?
Well, it must have been about 1934. That's what I think. Because I'll tell you why, and I think it was 1934. Because at some stage he met my mom. Because he used to go. He was much older than her. He was 9 years older than her. And I mean, he was more the generation of her parents than she. And that was a Jewish family who they used to go to. They met. Anyway, that's how they met. And then in 1936, when he went back to Poland, to see the family.
The mother had already died.
The mother had already died.
Yeah.
And he but had already.
That was his second visit back to Poland.
Why his second? Where
it
did
was,
you get
he
that?
Went before.
I don't know about that. No. He went on the Julius Caesar through the Suez Canal to Italy. And on to Poland.
To Genoa.
I think that's where we had photographs.
36, that's when you have photographs with him. And he had already decided to get married when he came back. That was the story with my mother. And he was in Poland and he went all over. He traveled all over in his suit and tie.
He went to Israel.
He went to Palestine, he went to Israel. He met Hannah and Menachem were already in Israel. He was in Lapy. And he, in Poland, he was in... He went to Bialystok, he went to Warsaw, he went all over. And then he came back and that was when there are pictures with you and Taffy and your parents and a whole lot of unknown cousins. And then they came back to South Africa. But I don't know.
Farewell party before he left.
we had a farewell party.
Yeah.
And in Johannesburg, before he left, my mom was there with someone else at the party, and they met there. And she came to say farewell on the boat, you know, not with the streamers.
On the train. It was from Joburg.
From Joburg to Cape Town, of course. Yeah. It couldn't have been on the boat from back home. I think she came to the party
with Mushy Berman.
Yeah, something like that. She came to the party with somebody else, and they met. And we have a letter written to Dear Edith, and that was in 1936 when he wrote letters to her from where he was.
Now that's where he must have told them all about Africa, and that there was a future in Africa. She didn't have to go to New Zealand.
Maybe.
Where she planned to go.
Yeah.
Where she wanted to go. And that's where they must have decided that my dad would go and try to come out. Do you have any recollections of this, Charles? Any recollections of this? Of that time?
No.
Of seeing Sam?
No. Not at all.
You completely lost
other than
memory.
The photographs.
He was only three.
I lost a lot more than my memory.
But I remember your mother saying when she first came to Mombasa, she said what a shock she got.
Very hot.
Not only hot, ala nakata medla.
What do you remember?
Yeah, it was more than that.
Charles? From the ship?
The ship, I don't remember Mombasa at all on arrival.
The ship?
He never got to see Gilkin again.
How amazing.
No, never.
That's amazing.
What do you know, Shah?
I just remember that he said with his first salary or something, with his first
Gilkin
few
back.
Salary, he paid Gilkin back. And you told me that he was starving there in Berlin.
That's what he told me.
And then afterwards, I never knew that afterwards he would have bread, too much bread in the house, as if, you know, storing food so that in case in bad times or something. And it took him time to get over that. That's what Colin told me.
When was that?
Colin remembers, Carl.
The thing is, that the reason for him leaving Poland must have been that it was very bad. And I don't know what year it was. I've got no idea when he left Poland.
He was 19. So 1907 and 1926.
About 25, 26. That's when he left. But that doesn't work out very, very well because there's overlaps in time and that doesn't. When Solly came and when he actually got to South Africa, he went through London, I know.
We are in just in front of the symbolic gates to the concentration camp, Treblinka 2. Settled right here, let's say, in July 1942, when the greatest extermination of the Jewish nation started in Poland. The concentration camp was settled here. The main reason was it was a very convenient point, because it was only 2.5 kilometers from the railway network that connected Warsaw and Małkinia. So basically that was a very convenient point. Do you know the reason why they decided to locate, I mean the Germans, concentration camps in Poland?
Because there were so many Jews here, no?
Not to do it in Germany, because they had, of course, they had concentration camps. But there was also the other reason. After the extermination process of the Jewish people, let's say in Poland, what they wanted to do, I mean the Germans, just to resettle the German people from the west to the east, like they said in their ideology, that the Third Reich is gonna be last for 1,000 years. So that was the main reason as well, just to exterminate the Jewish people first and then resettle in the cities and the villages the German people from the German territory. When 800 Jewish people tried to escape from that camp, stealing the machine guns and hand grenades, there was a revolt right here in the Treblinka. Some of them forced the main gate, this one, and they escaped to the local forests. Unfortunately, only 40 survived, because the rest of them were killed in the local forest by the Germans and Ukrainian guards. Okay. How many people, in your opinion, was a staff of that concentration camp? Do you know?
40.
No, 120. 120. 30 SS and 90 Ukrainian guards. So how is possible that it's 120 people in 1 year killed over 3,100 people?
300,000.
Yeah, 310,000 exact number is. Is it possible?
Why not?
Yeah, unfortunately it is, yeah. Okay, let's go.
Depends on the mechanism.
Yeah. The worst place in Poland, because when I led people to Auschwitz, I know what I can expect about their reaction. Right here, my mind goes very, very fast. What really happened was taking place right here, because there is nothing. That's why.
Right here.
And the, what we've got to look for in Bialystok or this street, Milnova Street, which we have a photograph of. Someone identified this as Milnova Street, and Milnova Street, the hotel is here, and Milnova Street is here. The hotel is here.
And
Milnova Street is here.
Okay.
And that was identified as Milnova Street by somebody.
On the train ticket.
No. This is Bialystok.
Just connected.
Yeah.
Do you know what it was?
Why? It was a photograph that we found in my dad's photos. And I sent it a couple of photos. Rachel Schlapak. כרטיס הנחה לרכבת
לפי
הכתובת הזאת והוא מצא את זה עכשיו באינטרנט ששם יש היום נגריה וטלפון
I think I know the story.
This is the first
time I've
seen
Kaila's.
This is Kaila's
mother.
Yeah. Which is Kaila's mother?
Look, this is... This is Kaila.
Yeah.
This is her mother. And this is apparently Hannah.
Uh-huh.
And these are the children, the rest. Hannah's...
But were the other brothers
and sisters, none of which survived.
And who's the dead person?
The fact that she was sick.
I don't know.
Hannah's mother. Hannah's mother, who was Kayla's sister.
Lieber Schwarz.
Lieber Schwarz.
But Yechiel Flicker, she was Lapy, Liftera, Marcheshonta, must be the year.
It's the date, so Zev would know what the date is.
Wait, I'll tell you in a minute. The date? The date?
Divorced and didn't divorce because it
meant Tarat, Zev.
Tarat.
Tarat. Mata Sarich Azot. Tarat. 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 No, I'm not sure.
1919.
Okay.
19.
Then they must have just come back.
From where?
Scheisse.
They must have just come back from Tambov.
From Tambov?
Yeah.
They came back from Tambov because in 70s was the revolution.
And Kaila was alive. Then you know Kaila was alive.
That's Kaila.
I know, so we know she was alive 1990.
Sure.
Sure she was. She died. I know when she died.
You know?
She was 11.
I know when she died because I got her grave. Yeah, here's her grave. She died in Tarja.
Where are all these pictures from?
You got to know. Yeah.
This is Kaila Gorfil. You've
been busy getting a bed. You didn't have time.
No.
Zev, Savta.
Zev, Savta. Zev, Savta. Sam the
Schnee Flynn. Ah.
Where would Solly have been? In South Africa?
Playing football.
Playing football.
He was in South Africa.
She came back because your dad came back and then she died. So. Oh, no.
Sell good.
Here is a railway line.
That looks like an old railway line. There's the tower, Cole.
Because as we're driving, we think of the Rub Kush. The Rub Kush. There's a feeling about it. This is the.
Right,
it's
fair.
Kids can play.
So nice, we have a play.
Look at this.
Nachon, this is your feet. Oh, a little garden. It's very rustic here.
Good fish too.
Much more townish. That's the town, but they didn't live in. Who thought they lived in the town? Because my dad had gone off to South Africa and Kenya. She had a shop below where they lived.
So it would be in
now,
town.
I don't know if this is the address. That specific, but she sold the shop in preparation, obviously, knowing. I presume that he was coming back and maybe to collect a bit of money and to have it in hand to the
some pole by the name. She has the name. She writes
really?
The yeah.
And did you tell? Name. Did you tell them the name? Have they got the name? Maybe the name. The oldest person they would know.
I didn't think of it.
Do you have it on you? Do
no,
you...
it's on the tape.
Where
this
is
man,
the tape?
And when the boys, Charles and Taffy, swung on the gate, he said, "I'll kill you if I ever see you here again." Mm. They lived upset. They just told him the property.
Really? You don't know English?
Look at the tomato.
Wow. And this is radish, beetroot.
You cook for
borscht.
Burakis. And here she's got
tissue maybe?
No, this is
Do.
This is
no. Samir.
This is not this is
Do. Do.
Koperek, koper. No, no.
It's not Samir.
Jak to wszystko bariera językowa.
Zup.
O, oh, to.
Ah, petrozilia. Parsley.
Do.
Yes.
No, petrozilia. Petrozilia, no. Petruszka, no.
Petruszka. Cilantro.
To nie kolendra, no.
Petrozilia.
Petrozilia, o. Si, for you. Poco italiano.
Italiano?
Poco. No.
There was in the shop and your mom said, materials. Hubert, those other streets that I gave you where the Jews used to live, mm-hmm. Can we find them?
We'll try.
This lady is. Seems to be, she brought us out some fruit.
Oh, lovely.
And a big plate of apples.
Uh-huh.
And she looks as though she maybe lives here and she could tell us maybe. This one on the corner.
She told us already.
How many is she?
But I showed her.
I didn't ask her.
I showed her that picture and she said something about a sugar mill, which might be. And the address you have could be the railway station.
No?
Or because these houses are belonging to the railways,
yeah.
So it could be the ticket office or something.
No, but listen, why in this area?
No, but that
yeah.
says
yeah.
that she used to live in Lapy on Kolejowa 34th Street.
And you don't take out a rail pass. You don't take a pass. For one journey, you go every day on that.
Yeah, apparently it's something like a 1 week ticket.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. 1 week ticket that yeah. says that the owner of the document
is traveling.
Has right to travel
every day.
One week.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So.
Okay, let's go to Munkach.
Where is the number?
On the Google
where
Earth.
Where is the number?
The Google Earth
there is a thing
gave this.
Is the White
this
House
place
the White House
as really? That number.
Did you take a picture of it?
But that house
that White House on the other side.
Because of the holy day of three kings. As Old Testament says, when Jesus Christ was born, three kings paid a visit. Bringing a lot of presents.
Mm-hmm.
Balthazar,
the Magi.
Yeah.
The Magi.
Yeah, exactly. So every day, every year, 6th of January, a priest pay a visit right here.
Mm-hmm.
The same in Warsaw, all over the country. Priests go to the apartments, private houses, then you give the donation to the church. And the last date in that house, I noticed, is 2007. So it's an empty house from 5 years ago, yeah. Yeah, because the street ends up right here.
This is number one?
This is number 21.
Which ones have a private? But the poor people
they get put in a like a factory, one on top of the other. And
think she wants it.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Oh, that, that?
No. I'm good. I?
That.
Israel?
Israel?
Yeah.
I'm good.
This. And I
make.
Rob,
you find
it.
You can ask
her
what's
it.
Yeah.
You
want to explain? Do you want to explain?
Mio.
Mio. Can we walk a little bit?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can.
Yeah, Pivo is beer.
Pivna is beer. Pivna.
Sorry, what's this called?
That in this street, this is one of the streets where the Jews lived in Wapi. Pivna Street, Jatka Street. Yeah. But it's there's nothing old here.
Well, this is more likely the place that Rochel would have a shop.
Shop. Maybe she would have a business here. You know, in this area. And she came by train from the house to here. That's my theory.
We'll have to ask her. Maybe a horse and cart.
And it's a long distance call to where she is.
No,
so,
yeah.
And
you don't think she went by train to her business call?
You don't think
no.
So?
No.
She train. She's too practical to have done that. She'd have lived. She'd have.
She used to walk
across the road.
So, anyway,
can
we? I don't know if it's.
Can.
If anything.
Let me look. And I put crop up. Man,
ask him if it's okay.
This is the.
The last time you were here.
The train is late.
Rose, I want to take a picture of you. This is the train you wait on, right? Could we call, say, local boy comes home? Kaila, where's the ticket? But haven't you got it here?
Hey?
Haven't you got it here, that ticket that you found?
No, it's
gone. Let's go into the ticket office and see what happens. No, I'm being serious.
After the second, that's sure.
Okay. And the one before the train station.
I don't know, it was a small one, but I don't know how to manage
it. Can you come and help us? We've just given her, ask her what she just said.
Not this.
I don't know.
Co to takiego jest?
Can we get a refund?
Is this the place?
No.
No. Is this the place?
No.
No. It hasn't. It was built after the war.
She didn't know. I
it's in the meantime.
Well, that's not Lapy. This is
amazing. I'm going to negotiate that one.
I wouldn't do that with my leg. I can't do that with my leg. All we have to do is
just unbreak a leg.
Either have one broken leg or two.
Must be a gate.
I want to lift.
Yeah, I could pick you up. I could sprint
and
over there.
And I could catch you.
Oh, that's nice. That's really very fun. Look, I tell you what. You do all that, and I give you one more lobby each. Now.
Okay, Molly, tell them that if they
come, wait.
There is no wall. Go that way.
What did she say?
If you walk there, there's no wall. Do I still get my lodi?
Oh, are you right?
What happened, Sharon?
She was doing what is called Sharon. I never knew that you could do a swallow dive.
Did you break your pocket? I didn't break anything, I'm okay.
Yeah, why didn't you wear your jeans?
I don't know, I just felt like wearing a skirt today. Oh,
a
python.
And listen, I'm standing on a fence.
On a fence.
Be on the offensive.
Yeah, here's a place.
Yeah, okay, I can see.
Okay. Okay. Careful of the... Oh. Kitty Granny, what are you
standing on? There's a gravestone.
This is just the thing. Okay, so you're going to be careful of the stone here. Like stepping up.
Maybe he was a founder of that school,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
So, Tony, right now it's not something like a mistake. For sure, it's not that for the correct way.
That's true, that's true. Yeah.
Okay.
Lovely school, isn't it?
המסגרות של החלונות
הן מקוריות.
Bardzo proszę. 3-4.
It was a part of the ghetto, and during the ghetto time that was a cemetery on Żabia Street, Rocky Street, translating was the name of the street. Żaba, Żaba.
Where they sent roughly 300,000 people to Treblinka in 9 months. Who left in the Warsaw ghetto? Only young people without any families, like Mordechai Anielewicz, like Marek Edelman, stuff like this. They were young and they realized what they are gonna do with them if they don't fight. It was a matter of honor for them to fight, because they knew they are gonna lose. But it was better for them to die during the uprising than be sent to Treblinka camp in the cattle wagons like pigs, if you know what I mean. So that was the main reason. Even Marek Edelman, one of the survivors, one of the commanders, said it wasn't a matter to be free, to get a freedom fighting against Germans in the ghetto. It was a matter of honor to be killed like a human being. That's the whole story.
How many survived here?
How many survived here? Let's say 2,000? 3,000, I don't know, to be honest. You mean in Białystok, yeah?
Yeah, how many took part in that revolt?
800. Yeah, and it was, you know, it was the same like in Warsaw Ghetto. They knew they are gonna lose. But they did exactly the same.
Mm-hmm.